course, I'm a lifelong resident. I'm a retired teacher of 32 years and an athletic director. I've been married to my wife for 35 years. So we've basically been together for quite a long time. I have a daughter, Nicole, who's active in the city. Okay. In reference to what I have done in the city, oh, wow, a plethora of things. I'm a member of Second Baptist Church. I'm a member of the Zoning Board. I am on part of the Dialogue Group in Asbury Park, a group that gets together twice a month just to discuss the problems of Asbury Park, not just on an economic standpoint, but from a racial standpoint. As far as my educational background, I was a student at Neptune High School, graduated in 1970, which makes me old, okay? I went to Monmouth University. I received an Associate of Art and a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration. I also have a Master's degree in Business Administration, but I decided that I didn't want to be a businessman anymore, so I went and became a teacher. When I became a teacher, I got a teaching certificate from Rutgers University by an alternate route, and then I went back to Rutgers Graduate School for Education and got my supervisor's papers and my administrative certificate. So I've been a lifelong student, as most people can see. In reference to what I do around town, I'm very active in my church, Second Baptist Church, 124 Atkins Avenue, where I am chairman of the men's ministry, serve as a deacon, and sing in the choir. We've been very active with youth in the community through our church. Also, as a youngster, I was active in the YMCA, the Boys Club, swimming, and Troop Number 37. As far as politics is concerned in Asbury Park, I got involved in politics rather late after I retired. I decided, even though there were many times I wanted to get involved in politics, I didn't, because I knew I couldn't devote the time that was necessary to politics, working one and a half, sometimes as many as two jobs. But what made me really want to get involved in politics is when my wife and I became foster parents. We raised five foster sons. We only have one daughter, but we raised five young men since we've been here in Asbury Park, and it made me realize that there are problems here in Asbury, not just in Asbury, but throughout the state of New Jersey, that need to be fixed. And a lot of times, a lot of poor people are being ignored. As I have grown older, I'm now a senior citizen, I look at the problems that senior citizens have in the city, and I think that we cannot allow our seniors to become forgotten people in our city. So that's one reason for getting involved in politics. I was also active in our Block Watch, which in 1995, we received an Outstanding Service Award from the city of Asbury Park. I'm also representative for District 3 as the male representative for the Democratic Party. So as you can see, I've been involved in quite a few things in Asbury. You're going to say, well, how do you have time to be a city council member? Very easy, make time. People need a voice. Everyone needs a voice. In the Southwest Quadrant, people feel helpless many times. The proliferation of absentee landlords, people living in substandard conditions, basically say, who can speak up for me? A lot of times they speak and their voice is not heard. So I want people to have a voice. I want you to say, look, if the paint is peeling on my wall, come to me. If you don't know who to go to, I'm going to help you learn who to go to. Not that I'm going to preempt social services, but a lot of people feel uncomfortable going to social services out of the fact that they have pride. Also, there's going to be a great deal of expansion in the Southwest Quadrant in the future. Not just in the future, but right now. And I think that we need to be on it, in it, and operating as a part of it. There are going to be jobs out there. And the jobs out there, we want our people, not just from the Southwest Quadrant, but all over Asbury Park, to be hired to work. We want to see jobs out there where when businesses come in, that people just don't go to the east side, they come to the west side for business. And also in the fact that what businesses out there, we want businesses on the Southwest Quadrant that produce jobs for all the people in Asbury, but just for the people on the west side. When we have to understand the demographics of the Southwest Quadrant, many people on the Southwest Quadrant walk or ride bikes. Because they walk or ride bikes, they can't get to Eatontown, Tenton Falls, farther north and farther south to work. They prefer to work in their community, especially young mothers and fathers who are raising children and need to be close to their kids. So I want to be a voice for those people. I want to make sure that when the Southwest Quadrant is developed, that these people, my people, me too, have a voice in the development of it. We actually did a survey on our own of what people want in the Southwest Quadrant. Nobody had ever asked these people on our side of town what they wanted with this development. When we sat down and did it, we found out that they want more recreation facilities, they want more social services, because people don't want to go to Freehold all the time to get social services taken care of, and they want bus routes. What people don't understand is in Asbury Park on Springwood Avenue, there's not a bus stop, but people live over there. They want a laundromat. When the work is done and it's completed, we want mixed use, and in that mixed use, we need a laundromat. People need a small grocery store to go to. Not everybody can afford to go to the mall. These are just things that I discovered by, one, doing my own survey, and two, when you go to have people sign your petition to run for office, you ask these questions. You just don't drop a petition off in a store and say, sign this for me so I can do something for you. That hands-on approach works, and that's gaining the trust of the people. But on top of that, if I'm in office, why do I want to be in office? Because I want to deliver. You can talk about it, you got to be about it, but you got to be able to deliver the goods. And I feel like I can deliver the goods to the people. They have misconceptions about people who are in poverty. People in poverty don't want to be in poverty all the time, okay, just because they're in poverty. Most people want to work. Most people want to work for a living. They feel good getting a paycheck. Here in Asbury, this is a hard working community. I have been here for 65 years, and the one thing I loved about Asbury Park is a blue collar community. Yes, we've seen changes with the beachfront, with higher income people going on the beachfront. I have no problem with that. But we want to make sure that everybody gets a piece of the pie in Asbury Park, especially with the development of the Southwest Quadrant. Am I mad? No. But I am passionate and aggressive, and that's why I want to be on City Council. Okay, I'm concerned about everybody. Let's start with the babies first. I'm concerned about the youth. The youth in Asbury Park, even though we have a wonderful recreation department, we're one of the top recreation departments in Monmouth County, if not the state, we can expand it more. Now, if that means hiring another person to help out, giving us more facilities, then so be it. But we need to keep our children active. When I was growing up, we actually used churches. I remember playing basketball at Holy Spirit Church in the little gym down in the basement, where different churches had different teams and we played against each other. But guess what? 2 days a week, everybody was off the street and everybody played. We remember playing basketball at the YMCA or the recreation program. Same thing, kids being active. Also in the city, we have a diverse population. So through recreation, we need to address this diverse population. While soccer is a popular sport around the world, it's not as popular sport in the United States like it should be. But we have population coming in here, especially the West Indian population and the Hispanic population, that love soccer. We need to put soccer leagues in here for the people so that they can participate and feel like they're a fabric of the community. Another thing I want to address is the fact that the senior citizens, and when I say senior citizens, I'm always talking about myself, okay? They need to be addressed. We have a great senior citizen facility that is pretty much not used as much as it should be used. They get great programs. I actually went there one time for a inclement weather program, I call it, and it taught us a lot about how to prepare for a hurricane, how to prepare for a snowstorm, and it helped us. Our seniors take trips all over the state of New Jersey, go to Atlantic City. I actually went up and saw an art show one time at North Museum with our senior citizens. But we have to once again address the needs of our senior citizens in reference to taking care of them. I feel that our senior citizens shouldn't even have to pay to get on the beach. I think they paid their dues, they've worked their whole lives. A lot of people are retired, they're on limited income, and I do not have the heart to charge them to get on the beach. I think that also in reference to our millennials, which my daughter is part of, we need to help them out. In reference to parking, parking at Asbury is at a premium. I constantly go to city council meetings and hear people complaining about parking. But what blew me away was that when doing some research, and I believe in Asbury Park, People down on Cookman Avenue and on the east side of town pay about $90 a year to park. I looked up West New York. In West New York, you pay $10 a year to park. How come we can't pay $10 a year to park for our people who are paying taxes in the city of Asbury Park? That's another one of my concerns. What else do I want to be concerned with? We have mental health problems in Asbury. These mental health problems lead to drug problems. We have groups in Asbury that want to help with the drug problem. Recently, they had to finally get this police officer's Narcan to help bring people back to life who are overdosing. But in the slowdown of doing that, how many people died? We need free syringe programs. We know we have drug problems, but we got to fix these drug problems. And one way we fix these drug problems is by helping these people, helping everybody who's a drug addict. I don't want to put people in jail because most people with drug problems don't need to be in jail. They need help. They need to be in the hospitals. They need to be in drug clinics. We would still a lot economically feasible for us to cure people than to lock people up for drug problems in Asbury Park and in Neptune. So I'm asking people to look, reach out. When you see a person on the street and he might be high, don't look down at him. Pray for him. Try to help him. See where you can send him to get some help. If you can't get him help, find some place to help him. We need to help all these people in Asbury because we're all part of the same community. In reference to our streets and corridors, we need to work with that, with adjoining towns, with Inner Lake and Lock Harbor, Neptune and Ocean Grove, just to fix our corridors, our bridges, our streets. We're a big community. Springwood Avenue, when Springwood Avenue stretches, it gets to Westlake Avenue and Neptune. Why do we need to talk to them? Because eventually Springwood Avenue is going to be a main thoroughfare to the beach. That's another opportunity for the Complete Streets program to kick in, where we will have bike lanes. We should have bike lanes on Springwood Avenue for people to get to the beach. We should have better walking paths on Springwood Avenue for people to get to the beach. We want people to use that space and not just say, this is a street that I have to avoid. Same thing for Asbury Avenue. We need to fix Asbury Avenue where people can bike over there. There's so many streets. That is a prime concern of my candidacy, of our candidacy, as we go forth in repairing Asbury Park. People say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. There are a lot of things that are changing around us. Just think about this. There was a study done with senior citizens that say if senior citizens have a safe neighborhood to walk in, they live longer. Now, we're already living longer, okay? But they will live longer, they're more at peace with themselves, and they feel safer. So we need to push that. We can't avoid our, just say to our seniors, oh, come on, sit in a nursing home. I was once injured in an accident, and I had to spend 6 weeks on my back in a rehab clinic. The saddest thing I learned was the amount of people who are in nursing homes who don't need to be there. These people need to have programs. They have worked their entire lives. And while some nursing homes do a fabulous job taking care of these people, there's nothing like being outside, walking around, expressing yourself, going through the park. Asbury has that. We have parks, we have beaches, we have a boardwalk. It should be a haven for our retirees. They shouldn't have to run to Ocean County to go to a retirement village. They should be right here in Asbury Park with us. My final thing for Asbury Park is to keep everybody in Asbury Park, in Asbury Park. Now, when you say in Asbury Park, in Asbury Park, what's that about? In the process of me going around getting my 208 signatures so I could run for office, I walked on the east side, I walked over by the high school, and I walked on the west side. But what I found out, when I was in Cookman, on Cookman Avenue, people were doing a lot of renting, but they didn't want to leave Asbury Park. When I went over to the area by the high school, that's a beautiful side of town, people over there basically were the same people who were renting on Cookman Avenue. And now they had bought in Asbury Park and want to stay in Asbury Park. We have to make it easier for them to stay in Asbury Park by making sure that our taxes don't fly through the roof, that things are comfortable. Yes, we have to get a couple ordinances in shape in reference to people coming in on weekends treating Asbury Park like it's New Orleans. This is not New Orleans. This is Asbury Park, a proud community. But we want people who are renting on Cookman Avenue, who are renting on that section of town, to be able to come to the other side of Asbury Park and take part and have a beautiful home so that they can raise their children. We need a working together of the Board of Education of Asbury Park and the City of Asbury Park. We don't want people to have to send their kids to private school to get a quality education. There's one day, Dr. Repelette and I were talking, and I said, Doc, can I say something honest to you? He said, yeah, you always do. I said, we will have arrived when white people don't mind sending their kids to Asbury Park schools. That is what we are working towards. We want Asbury Park to be the school system that I grew up in, which was an inclusive school system for all races, all economic status of people, and all religious groups to come together and get educated. Because when that happens, we learn about each other. So we want an inclusive, homogeneous community. That's what I want to address. Thank you. Work for all the people. Obviously, being from the Southwest Quadrant, my heart is over there. I've seen changes come. I expect to see more changes, and I want to make that part of town and the people on that part of town inclusive in those changes. But do we want to welcome other people into the Southwest Quadrant? Yes, we do. We want everybody to be able to come over there. My next door neighbor on one side of me is Puerto Rican, and his wife is Mexican. The next house over, the people are Jamaican. In my neighborhood, 5 people own houses that are retired. What we want to see in Asbury is home ownership for everybody. I want to make sure that as people reach their ages of senior citizens, that they don't have to sell their houses, that they don't have to get these reverse mortgage loans which put them deeper in debt to keep their houses. Okay. I also want to make sure that we are able for people to be able to buy houses in Asbury, young millennials, where they can get started and where they will remain in the community. That's why it's important that we have bike paths. That's why it's important that we fix the drug problem. That's why it's important that we go hand in hand with the Board of Education. That's why it's important that our recreation programs are not just recreation programs, but our mentoring programs. There's nothing wrong with having a program like Project Oasis, which is in Montclair, New Jersey, where kids go to school in the summer, and in the summer they actually go and they study and they do reinforcement on what they're learning in the classroom. They learn how to use computers, and then they come outside and they play after that. And also, that takes the weight off the parent in reference to, where do I keep my child? You know your child's in a safe haven. We trust our teachers. We trust our people. Also, I hate to say this, hardcore on hiring people in Asbury for Asbury jobs. And I have said this many times, I'm not just talking about the lower level jobs. I'm not just talking about the guys who work on the boardwalk. I'm saying that of all people in Asbury, both black, white, and Hispanic, gay and straight, want us to stay together as a community. As people work, they must be able to climb that ladder, and when those administrative jobs become available, that they be considered for those administrative jobs. I know we want the best people in the best positions to do what is best for the city, but these people are in Asbury. They were educated in Asbury. They live in Asbury, and there's no reason why they have to leave Asbury. I received a master's degree in business administration at Monmouth University. The one thing I always remember was something called the multiplier effect. If you take a dollar and you keep that dollar in the community, that dollar will grow 10 times. We cannot continue to hire from outside our community, especially for our higher level jobs, okay? So that people just leave and the money's gone. Another thing we have to do with our local developers, we have to make sure that we cut out the red tape when they do try to do development projects. A lot of times, we make it so hard for them to build houses, we make it so hard for them to develop lots, that those lots lie fallow. I would love to see the dollar store that they were talking about go up. Why? Not that I'm in love with the people building the dollar store. He's a man who's trying to work to make a living. But if that dollar store went up, that would give 20 or 30 jobs to people in Asbury Park. Nobody's going to drive 25 miles to work in the dollar store. That dollar store is going to employ people from Asbury, just as the Rite Aid employs people from Asbury, just as the Walgreens and Neptune employs people from Asbury and Neptune. When I go on Walgreens and Neptune and Neptune, I see Asbury Park High School graduates working there. I want to see the same thing here in Asbury. The beach does a good job. We understand that a lot of the small business owners have to hire people from their family and hire people that they trust. No problem. But when it comes to a lot of these jobs where you have 20 and 30 jobs available, it's no reason why people from Asbury can't work with those jobs. And once again, I hate to go back to it, but I'm going back to it when we talk about that Complete Streets thing. That Complete Streets thing program plays right into what we want, because the people who want those jobs don't necessarily own a car. So we need to make sure that people who don't have cars, who ride bicycles, and who walk to work have venues of employment close to home. That keeps them close to home. That means that if they feel their children are safe, if something happens to a child in school, they don't have to go 50 miles to get home for an emergency, and they are active in the community. You work in the community, you spend in the community, you love that community. So that's what we want to do for Asbury Park, okay? And if I'm elected, it's going to be done. And to the seniors and the young people, don't worry. We're going to get you those free beach passes. Have a good day.
My name is Amy Quinn. I'm the deputy mayor in Asbury Park. I'm a nonprofit legal service attorney, meaning we represent people who qualify for a service and can't afford a private attorney. So we represent people who live at or near the poverty line, and we also represent people who are disabled in a wide range of legal matters, anywhere from housing discrimination to Social Security to you're losing your Section 8 voucher. And if there's, you know, essentially a public entitlement that you are being denied or that you are being terminated from, our office will look into representing you. Oftentimes judges assign us, and we do walk-ins, mainly, you know, phone call, somebody refers somebody who says, you know, can you help us out? Medicaid terminations, you name it. I have lived in Asbury Park for, I think, about 16 years now. I moved here from Jersey City. When I was living in Jersey City, I was working for the Division of Youth and Family Services as a child protective service worker, and I was going to law school at night. So I was looking to take a break from work for my last year so I could finish up my last year of law school. And moving to Asbury Park, or to be honest, I initially just wanted to move by the water. And a number of people had said, you should check out Asbury Park. You should check out Asbury Park. Back then, Asbury Park was the only place I could afford, and I loved the vibe that was here back in 2000. You know, there was a lot of diversity, a lot of creative types and gay people. And so I bought a unit in the Santander and lived in that unit until July of 2015, where I bought a house on 3rd Ave. I got involved in politics. It's a little bit of a strange story. So when I was living in the Santander, I would run around Deal Lake, and one morning I was running around Deal Lake, and a truck was putting Canadian geese that were there in the truck, and I found out a few days later that they were gassing the geese. That's how one of the towns bordering Deal Lake was dealing with their geese population. And I was very upset about that, and I think I made some comments on social media and did some other things, and somebody named Tom Pavinsky from the Environment and Shade Tree Commission reached out to me and asked me if I would get involved in the Asbury Park Environment and Shade Tree Commission, because they were also having a problem with geese, but the difference with Asbury Park was that they were looking for humane ways to deal with the problem. So I met Tom Pavinsky. I got on the Environment and Shade Tree Commission maybe 10 years ago now, and remain on the Environment and Shade Tree Commission. It's actually one of my favorite commissions. And that was my first step into any sort of committee, commission, or kind of political world. So I think that question starts with 2013, and why did I run in 2013? And one of the reasons I ran in 2013 was because, you know, I didn't feel heard by our local city government and our local city council. And going through the entire campaign process in 2013 and hitting, you know, thousands of doors and introducing ourselves, you know, there were consistencies that we heard, and those consistencies also, I felt the same way. So in 2013, the biggest problem in Asbury Park was crime. No matter where you lived, when we knocked on your door, generally that was what you were the most concerned about. The second issue that most people were concerned about was redevelopment. It was a period of time in Asbury where we didn't have any new projects going up anywhere around the town, and people felt that redevelopment was stalled. I also felt that. And The third thing I think has to do with kind of fiscal responsibility in the day-to-day operations in City Hall. So I had felt, and I think we heard it on the door, that people weren't really feeling heard by the city government. They weren't feeling helped by, you know, sometimes they weren't feeling helped by some of the city staff. And so getting elected in 2013 and spending the last 2 or 3 years trying to rectify those problems, and I believe successfully rectifying a number of them, you know, our crime rate has been the lowest it's been since 1979. We've, you know, done things in terms of fiscal responsibility. We've reduced Asbury's debt. We've brought in a full-time CMFO. We've brought in a new city manager. We've brought in a new city planner. We've brought in a new city clerk. And those were some of the ways we tried to address some of the fiscal responsibility. So from big, which is like bringing in a new CMFO, we also put GPS on vehicles, so we knew where the vehicles were going. We did tracking on the gas, on the city gas, so we knew how much gas people were using for the trips that they were taking. And starting to do that over the course of the last 3 years, I think has shown, you know, complete improvement in some of the affairs in City Hall and some of the fiscal responsibility that's going on. And quite frankly, I want to see all of that continue to go forward. I want to continue to take input from residents who wanted a business committee. So businesses had felt that their concerns weren't being heard, so we started a business committee so we could have a direct dialogue with them. And it's, you know, those kind of problem-solving measures make me want to run again in 2016, and I'm hoping that, you know, with the city and the individuals who live in this city, you know, with their input, with their ideas, we're going to continue to be able to move things forward. I think if I had to say what the number one biggest concern I have for Asbury Park is, it's going to kind of lose all of the things that make it such a great city. It's, you know, we run the risk of losing the diversity, we run the risk of losing the artists, the musicians, the historic preservation, because we get bigger and bigger and bigger. And I think the idea that all of the things that make Asbury Park great, similar to the things that I'm mentioning, that those things could somehow be priced out of Asbury Park or could somehow leave Asbury Park is one of my biggest concerns. So that's kind of the umbrella of what I'm overall concerned about. And some of the ways that we're hoping to kind of deal with that, and I think using redevelopment as just an example of what we're trying to do to deal with the fact that, you know, we have $700,000 or $800,000 or $900,000 condos on the waterfront right now, is doing redevelopment on Springwood Ave. And not only redevelopment on Springwood Ave, but what we're doing is using mixed uses with mixed income. So we're going to be able to provide condos and townhouses to people who can't afford the $700,000, $800,000, $900,000 condo, but absolutely want to remain in Asbury Park and love Asbury Park. And this council has absolutely made Springwood Ave and the redevelopment of Springwood Ave a priority, so we could ensure that people would be able to stay in Asbury Park. The idea that the people who didn't leave Asbury Park when everybody left and stayed through the good times and the bad, the artist community, the musicians, the painters, the gay community, all of these kind of different factions who over the, you know, 70s, 80s, 90s, and 2000s, you know, are a huge part of its rebirth. And what would be horrible to me is for, you know, any of those factions to be priced out of Asbury Park. One of the first things that I would pledge to do is to continue to keep redevelopment moving forward in Asbury Park with a specific focus on Springwood Ave. What we've been able to do by obtaining the grants for Springwood Ave, over $10 million worth of grants and a $500,000 grant for planning of Springwood Ave, is to start making sure that these developments get off the ground and that they're held to deadlines. You know, we've been good about making sure developments move forward on the east side, and we're going to continue to be good about making sure development moves forward on the east side. And I think an example that I can pledge to you is that the skeletal site on Ocean Ave, which is often referred to as 1101 or the former Esperanza, that's something that we're absolutely going to get up and built if I'm elected, within the 4 years that I'm elected. And we're going to put a lot more focus on Springwood Ave. You know, our success on Springwood Ave obviously was the park, a park that was supposed to be built in like 2009. It never got built. And through a lot of hard work, we were able to get that park built, and if anybody went there over the summer, you saw what an amazing experience it was, what a diverse group of people, a diverse bands from reggae to gospel. And those are just two examples of kind of what we've done with redevelopment and how I want to see it move forward. I pledge in 4 years to get us off transitional aid. The city's slowly but surely reduced the transitional aid number, and we're now getting approximately about $1 million in transitional aid. In the next 4 years, I hope to be receiving no transitional aid whatsoever. And why that's important is transitional aid requires us to, one, raise your taxes because the state's giving us money to sustain ourselves, and two, gives us no ability to stabilize taxes or make our own decisions or to some extent, you know, put money where we think it should be put, because every decision needs to be run by the state. And so if we can get off transitional aid, stand on our own 2 feet, not only do I think that's like metaphorically a great thing, I think fiscally it's a great thing. Because we were able to hire a full-time CMFO, a new city manager, a new city clerk, a new city planner, a new tax collector, because we were able to do all of those things, I see us getting off transitional aid in the next possibly 2 years, 3 years. I think it'll be before the 4 years. So those would be two things that I absolutely pledge to do. I also pledge to make workforce development a priority. And what I mean by that is meshing the locals in this town who have a skill set or want a skill set with the redevelopment that's going on in this town. And if we can kind of mesh those two things, I think truly the sky's the limit, right? So we're going to get our unemployment numbers up, and we're going to start training and hiring locally for, you know, the big redevelopment projects going on in Asbury Park. And I absolutely pledge to do that with the hope that we would have a redevelopment office in Asbury Park at some point. And we've started that with, we have RFP'd for redevelopment, a request for proposals for workforce redevelopment. And we are moving forward on that, and I pledge to move forward faster on that over the next 4 years. And I just want to add that, you know, the women I'm running with, this ticket is really a reflection of the diversity of Asbury Park, right? It's, you know, a wide range of ages, you know, black, white, gay, straight. This ticket, I think, really reflects, you know, the population in Asbury Park and the diversity that makes Asbury Park one of the best cities on the East Coast.
Hello, my name is Kenneth Edward Saunders Jr. I currently live in Asbury Park. I've lived in Asbury Park my entire life. I went through the Asbury Park school system and went on to college. I went on to college to get a degree in nursing, a field that I love as well. I decided that after I got my degree, I decided that I wanted to live in Asbury Park. So I bought a home here, a home that was not in the greatest shape, but I revamped it, and I love my home in Asbury Park. I am currently a registered nurse. I am the manager of an operating room. I have a daughter who's 8 years old, who is the joy of my life. I got into politics about, let's say, 4 years ago when I was elected to the Board of Education. My thing is that education is the key for all people. And I wanted to help our city because we were struggling at the time. We are on an uprise, as I noted on our last board meeting last night. And that was so cool to see the positive things that we're doing. I'm running for city council in order to be the voice of the city. And you will hear me say this so many times during this interview. I want to be the voice of the entire city of Asbury Park. Over the few years, this city has gone through a renaissance, and I love it. The diversity, I love the atmosphere, I love the energy of this town. This is my home, and I love it, and I want to just be a part of the community service as far as being on the city council. That's why I'm here. Thanks. I'm running to be on the city council to be the voice of Asbury Park. It doesn't matter if you're from the east side or the west side. What I've learned is that the people who live here love this city, and so do I. We are excited about what's going on in our city. There's redevelopment, there's shops, there's a school system that's going in a positive direction. There's a lot of growth here. I want to do what's right for the community. I know that sometimes there's a division in our within politics and within the city council. I want to be that bridge that brings people together. Now, it doesn't matter where you're from, again, or where you're at. My goal is to bring us together so we can come up with solutions to help our city grow and continue in the right direction. That's why I'm running for city council. Thank you. My biggest concern is these blighted properties that are all throughout our city. We live in a beautiful city, and these are eyesores to us. As a property owner, there are two boarded up houses that are right next to me. Now, I'll give you a little history. My house didn't look the best initially, but through hard work and through hard work and effort, I renovated my entire property. My property, right as of right now, looks great. I like the way it looks. I like the way it sits. I love it. But right next to me, there are two abandoned properties. I think that the city council can be a part of renovating these properties. I did a newspaper article just about 2 years ago, and they focused on these blighted properties, and nothing was done. As a homeowner, you want to live in the best neighborhood possible. I think that the city council should make the owners of these properties responsible. I think that as a city councilman, that would be my goal, to make these property owners responsible for these blighted properties. I noticed that in other towns, you don't have that as much as in Asbury Park. Now, everyone's passionate about Asbury Park, but to see these properties is depressing, basically. I think that we as city council people should either take them over, make the land owners responsible, and do what's right for the community. I also would like to see more middle class housing on the east side. You have tons of land over there, and to have middle class housing would be the best for the entire community. It would raise up the spirits of the east side, of the west side, and it would make our town more beautiful. Thank you. If elected, I pledge to be the voice of Asbury Park. Doesn't matter what side you come from, no matter where you are in the town, be your voice. A lot of elected officials give lip service. I can't do that. You guys, as citizens of Asbury Park, are the people that I love. I grew up in this town all of my life, and to see it where it is as of right now, I'm head over heels for this town. I love this town. I also have a passion for the blighted properties, the eyesores of this town, and I will work with the city council to help rectify this whole entire situation. Citizens of Asbury Park, I would not fail you. I'm always open to suggestions, and I would do anything it takes to make this a better town. I also would want to work with small businesses. We have tons of businesses throughout our town. I want to see more shops, more restaurants. It's a joy to just walk down Cookman Avenue. Citizens of Asbury Park, I love you guys. Please vote for Ken Saunders Jr.
I'm Eileen Chapman, and I am a citizen of Asbury Park. I've lived here since 1974. My husband and I raised three children here, and we remained here when many other families and businesses were moving out of our city. In the 1970s, my father, Bill Scheel, was the city manager, and from my father, I developed a love of politics. I've always kept a watchful eye over our city fathers, and I've attended council meetings throughout the years. I've not been afraid to express my views and my opinions, even when those opinions were not popular, and even through the most difficult times. I often wrote letters to the planning board when I felt that the plans that were presented to our city were not necessarily in the best interest of the entire city. I believe in my city, I love my community, and I believe we have a lot to offer. We have the new Springwood Park, where we had the Levitt Series concert, which brought people together for 8 consecutive weeks. It was a place where people gathered, and when people gather, it becomes a community. I think politics led me to make commitments to many activities and organizations and events. As my children were young, I was a class mother, a Brownie leader, a Girl Scout leader, a Boy Scout leader. I was a Little League volunteer. And then those commitments grew. I helped former Mayor Jimmy Bruno put together the July 4th parade. I worked on Oyster Fest, New Harmonies. I'm on the board of the Asbury Park Historical Society. On the board of Asbury Angels, and I've really been involved with the city because I believe in it, and I believe commitment is a big part of what we do when we're engaged in our community. I'm running for the Asbury Park City Council because the future of Asbury Park is important to me. I believe this current council has made amazing strides in the last few years. I think the growth has been tremendous. I think we've all seen the outcomes, and this is something that I want to be a part of. I am part of an amazing team, a diverse team, that brings each a unique perspective to the table. We are financially and fiscally responsible, we're transparent, and we listen to our stakeholders. I believe that our stakeholders are going to help us continue to grow this city forward. We have just received a $500,000 Choice Neighborhood grant for neighborhood planning on the west side. We've just put out an RFP for the City Hall property in order to develop a garage, retail, and office component. And going to see the first shovel to the ground at 1101 Ocean Avenue. That will be buildings, restaurants, retail, condos, and parking. This is all part of the growth that I'd like to see continue. One of my biggest concerns is that we need to promote a balance. We need to offer new development, but we still need to preserve our history. We need to work with local developers as well as major developers, because local developers bring something to the plate that addresses the needs of the community, whether it's jobs or housing. We will get that from local developers. Major developers will bring in the revenue that we need. So I think keeping the balance of both is important. I think we also need to listen to the diverse needs of our population. One of the other things I want to make sure that we do is that we preserve our lakes, our parks, and our open spaces so that they're available and accessible to our residents for recreational use and for different types of activities. I think we also need to promote our vibrant businesses in town, but still make sure that we provide the quality of life necessary for our residents. I think these are all transformative things that are happening in our city, and we just need to make sure that it's balanced. As a city councilwoman, I believe the foundation is set for many great things to happen. I believe fiscal responsibility is very important to the positive and diverse growth in our city. I'll work with the budget committee, who will then work with our city leaders to ensure transparency and confidence. I also believe that everyone must play a role in our city government. I think it's important for our residents to become engaged, to be involved with commissions and committees, and have their voices heard, because we can't represent the citizens if we don't know what they're thinking and what they're saying. I'd like to ensure that the children in our community have the tools and the skills that they need for them to grow up to be civic leaders as well. And I think part of that is arts and culture. And, you know, I think with the new stage in Springwood Park, I think there's opportunities for children there, as well as music at the Lake House. And out of art and culture, you often see a political commitment arise. I'll work with developers, local developers, and major developers to ensure that there are job opportunities and job training for our citizens. And I'll maintain a complete dialogue with the Complete Streets Coalition to make sure that our roads and pathways and walkways are safe and accessible for all of our citizens. I'd like to just ask everyone to please vote for myself, Amy Quinn, and Yvonne Clayton in this year's election. I think that the growth that everyone has seen over the last few years is transformative, and we'd like to see that move forward in a positive direction.
Stephen Williams, 833 Central Avenue. Everybody know me as Steve. I graduated of the greatest class to ever come through Asbury Park School District, the class of 2002. I'm a lifelong bishop. I'm a record holder here in Asbury in two sports, basketball and football. I'm part of our elite 1,000-point club. Not everybody can do it. I'm also the all-time leading receiver in football here. I'm also one of the great intellects that come through this community. I like to consider myself a product of this community. I was born and raised right here from the southwest side of Asbury Park. Made it to Delaware State University for both my undergrad and graduate degrees. One in sport administration, which is my graduate degree. My undergraduate degree is in sport management with a minor in marketing. I got 6 credits toward my doctorate. Took a pause to come back to actually work for the city back in 2010. That's where I started. I was a part of starting one of the greatest programs I've ever seen come to fruition, from just a couple of minds coming together and starting the Asbury Park Recreation Academy, where we focused on our student athletes and some of our great academic students and helped them get placed in the college and into our workforce and into our armed forces. All my parents, both my parents are from Asbury, my grandparents are from Asbury, my entire family is about 50 of us running around here. Anything you want to know, if you ever see me in the community, just ask me. I'm an open book. And a little bit about that, Asbury Park Recreation Academy, I was considered the assistant director under the regime. A couple of people were still here that worked for the city, Ms. Leisha Floyd, James Familaro, who's no longer with the city, but the program entailed insinuating kids' positives by, we got away from the word mentoring and we leaned more into coaching. The word coach is synonymous with a person who's relevant in your life or has a great part of your life for the majority of your life from the time of their inception into your life. So we got away from the term mentor to coach. So when you hear me refer to someone as coach, that's a term of endearment. Not only as someone who helped me pave my way, but somebody who showed me the ropes in life and helped me become the man that I am. I'm a lifelong member at the Monmouth County Boys and Girls Club. Became a member in 1989. I was also a member of the YMCA over here on Main Street. It was Young at Heart. I don't know what it became since, but I was a member in both recreational facilities. I'm an open book. Any questions, just ask me. I'm a member of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated, a fall in this year of Fall 09. I'm a number 2, what we call the Deuce. And I'm active in this community. Thank you.
Several reasons. The main reason is being equality, I would say, for the lack of a better term or a better thought. There's a lot going on, moving progressively in the right direction in the city, but I believe that is a population, small population, right over here on the Southwest Quadrant that's left out. These people that who I believe I represent, I am one of them, they bring so much to the table that's overstepped or pushed aside or not even sought after, that they become disenfranchised at this point in life, to be honest. There's a lot of wheels broken over here, but a job, an internship, a coach or mentor could do so much for these people, can do so much for the people of the Southwest Quadrant, as people have done for me. I know the importance of having a mentor. I know the importance of being strong in my family. I know the importance of being strong in my community. And the same values that I know and understand that are strong for me is the same for the people over here in the Southwest Quadrant. And that's not to say that it's not a lot of people over here on the east side or the northeast side that are not strong in this community, because I have a rather unique privilege to be a part of both the entire community. I get to see how people work. I get to see how people operate. I get to see how is a little bit of disenfranchisement on one side, but it's only a bunch of people on the other side that want to help, but they don't know how to go about helping because there's no communication, there's no dialogue. Part of the reason I want to run is to create that dialogue. The narrative has to be created in order to invoke some change. Someone asked me, what makes you different than any of us? I'm no different. I just pay attention. I try to be observant. I try to be a sponge to anyone in any environment that I'm in, from anyone. So that means if somebody have information to give to me, I'm open and willing to receive it. Open-heartedly, open mind. That's the only way things can happen. Now the question is, why am I running for city council? That's just one reason. The other reason is our youth. It's a disproportionate death rate at this time in our lives, or at this time in the community. It's a disproportionate arrest rate. It's high arrest rates here in Asbury Park, and it's only happening in one area of the city. It's only happening in one area of the city. And someone like me, 33 years old, I can bridge that gap. I can create the dialogue. I can have those people on the east side meet those people on the west side or the southwest side, get to talking, ideas get to flowing, and some good things can happen. And I know that. And that's why that's the main reason I'm running, to strengthen our youth, to strengthen our core of people in the city of Asbury Park. And I'm not just talking about east-west thing. I'm talking about the entire city. The entire city, 1.42 square miles. I want to see everybody happy. I want to make sure that everybody has everything at their fingertips or to their disposal to be great as they can possibly be. For instance, we're a walking town. There's no reason we should have a four-lane highway going north and south. There's no reason we should have a four-lane highway. Main Street should not be four lanes to me. If you look at any other city that's just as small or just as populated as Asbury Park or that lines the shore like Asbury Park, let's take Hoboken for example. They adopted a road digest plan. They have bike lanes, they have walking lanes, they have workout parks, they have dog parks, they have leisure activity, things that we don't have, but we have the facilities, we have the space, we have everything in place to create these things. Think about it. It's a lot of development going on. It's kind of slow to develop your buildings and your grounds, but not develop your streets to accommodate those buildings. We have New Jersey Transit, walking distance throughout the whole town. Why not have a bike rack set up over here at the train station where people can ride their bikes, save money on gas, save money on possible car accidents or insurance, and take the train to work, to wherever they have to go. I want to see bigger business. See, now my counterparts, my running mates, they want to see just businesses, which is cool, more homegrown businesses. I'm younger, I'm millennial. I want to see bigger businesses to help cut taxes. If you look at Neptune, it's crazy that Neptune is three times the size of Asbury, if not four times the size, but pay half the taxes. That's crazy to me. Know why? They have a Home Depot there. They have a Walmart there. They have several hotels. They have Rita's. They have a ShopRite. They have a Food Town. It's things that we need here. They have gas stations. We have one gas station in a city that's roughly, what, 17 to 20,000 people? There's so many other issues at hand. Again, the senior citizens are kind of a forgotten population here in Asbury. It's some things that we need in place. Maybe free recreation for the seniors. Maybe it's a senior day to recognize them. I like to see that all residents of Asbury probably pay a nominal fee of $5 or $10 to get on the beach. There's no reason that you live in a city and have to pay to get on the beach. Parking is terrible. I like to eat at the brick wall. I like to eat on the boardwalk. I like the crepe station. I love it. I like to go to Watermark. I like to go to Porter. But the fact that I have to pay for parking on the curb, and I'm a resident, I pay taxes just like everybody out there. That's a problem to me. Much richer cities pay way less in parking, pay way less for their beach passes. Hoboken being one, they pay $10 a year for just parking. East Orange being another, they pay $20 a year. Long Branch pay a cheaper beach pass rate than us, and they have a lot going on the beach with Pear Village and everything. So when you put these things into perspective, what is the benefit of living in Asbury other than the location? The location is great, yes. It's awesome. It's a jewel. You don't have major highways coming in and out. That's why we should have bike lanes. Because the risk of accident is very low here, as opposed to other places where we have Highway 35, Route 18, the Parkway, the Turnpike, Route 9, Route 1. They're running through Route 430. It's running through these and Route 400. It's running through these other towns. We don't have those issues. We're in a little nook of our own here. We're in a little nook of our own. And another thing I would love to see come to fruition is the two largest employers in the city of Asbury Park, the city of Asbury Park itself and the school district, work hand in hand. Find a way to accommodate the people. Include the people in everything that's going on. That creates transparency. It creates trust. Right now, it's a lack of trust for our law enforcement. Know why? There's no review of our law enforcement. There's no review of our law enforcement. And that's not just a Southwest Quadrant thing. We did a survey. It's people over here that is pretty disgusted with our law enforcement. Business owners, residents, and just visitors alike. I like to see the living wage, not a minimum wage. Minimum wage is telling you, you're getting paid pennies. You're going to work hard and get paid pennies. You should work and get paid for the work in which you're doing, and that could help you pay for where you live. Asbury Park is not inexpensive to live in. It's very expensive to live here. And to have companies come in, like I said, industry, that heightens pay, that heightens opportunity, that heightens exposure. So with that happen, when that comes, because by bringing them businesses here, we know that Asbury is a beautiful city. Them businesses will come here and they'll bolster our city. Before you know it, we already know nationally, but make us internationally known, because a lot of businesses are international. And I'll say a living wage, because you gotta understand, nobody gets by on minimum. Mediocrity. Nobody gets by on. Our recreation is in the dumps. We have a recreation department that works hard, but they don't have enough manpower. They don't have enough innovative ways of getting recreation out to our youth, to our seniors, or to people my age. I still play basketball, but I gotta go to Rebound to play. I gotta go to Belmar Courts to play. I do play here in Asbury, but I can't get proper competition. But with that said, I want to see the youth get some backing. I want to see our police held accountable. I want to see parking dealt with. I want to see beach passes at a nominal fee for everybody. I want to see the right economic situation for everybody. And I just want to see everybody thrive. That's why I'm running for city council. First thing I want to do is do what works. Get out and talk to the people. We understand that, all right, it's not an east-west thing. Asbury is too small for that. I said that the first time I ran for city council, but this time I understand what politics mean. Before, I had no understanding of really what politics was. Politics is people and money. That's all politics is. I'm not saying to be greedy, and I'm not saying to be one-sided on things. If you know how to deal with people, if you know how to communicate with people, what's going on, you're able to get the necessary and pertinent information from them, disseminate it to the rest of the council, and then let us work with our city officials to make things happen for the people. Because at the end of the day, we're here to work for the people. And that's what we have to keep in mind. The difference with me, I understand the people. I talk to any and everyone. Just again, like I said before in one of the segments, I'm a sponge. I like to talk. I like to listen. I like to learn. Without learning about who you're living around, who you're working around, who you're playing around, because we live, work, and play in such a beautiful area, we need to know everybody and everything that's going on around us. And the only thing I see coming from that is progression. We're talking about redevelopment. I want Asbury to develop into a small metropolis if possible. But I want to see an all-inclusive effort. I want to see all-inclusive jobs, all-inclusive living. That's what I want to see. We have a corridor that's untapped in Lake Avenue. It goes down into Neptune. We need to work with our neighboring cities. We need to work with them. We need to make sure our youth is safe, our youth have things to do, and they have the right outlets to bolster their abilities, their capabilities, and their learning acumen. Because at the end of the day, everybody's not Albert Einstein and everybody's not Michael Jordan. So in that in-between, we got to make sure everybody's taken care of. We got to create the dialogue of making sure that our seniors, our millennials, and just the people that's everyday movers and shakers has everything at their fingertips. Everything at their fingertips to make sure they're doing their jobs right, they're living well, and they're being healthy and safe about everything they're doing. The main thing I want to see is us create programs or initiatives. I dislike the word programs. Initiatives. People respond to initiative and incentive. Remember that. Remember I told you this here on APTV. People respond to incentive and initiative. If we place our kids as strong as their minds are in situations to win, and not be so quick to judge, not be so quick to arrest, not be so quick to move, I guarantee we'll see an influx in our economy, we'll see an influx in safety, we'll see an influx in communication amongst the whole city. If everybody played their part and played it to the best of their ability, Asbury can be the best place in the state of New Jersey, if not the country, to live. And that's just me. Maybe I'm being facetious, or maybe I'm even being a little one-sided or a little selfish here because I'm from here. I know the potential, and potential is nothing but untapped happenings. That means we need the best people in place to pull this potential out of our kids. We need to make sure our seniors are protected by these youth. We need to make sure our officials are held accountable in their jobs. We need to make sure our teachers are held accountable in their classrooms. We need to make sure that anybody that's in a service area is held accountable for their service. And vice versa, we need to make sure our youth is held accountable for any right or wrongdoing. If it's right, we need to make sure it's an incentive in place. If it's wrong, we need to make sure it's either a consequence or some type of learning tactic in place, as opposed to just locking them up and throwing away the key. We need to make sure our Mexican, Haitian, Jamaican, and West Indian population has outlets, because there are very, very few outlets here for them. Whether we like it or not, Asbury is a melting pot. If y'all don't know, Asbury was formed and shaped after the borough of Brooklyn, New York. We have our streets going one way, we have our avenues going one way. One thing that Asbury and Brooklyn really have in common is that is a melting pot. There's many cultures here. There's many different people here. Many different ways and ways of knowledge and ways of doing things that we make and tap into each other and take from and add to our lives. Think about that. The point of me running is to be a vessel. I work for the people. That's what I'm here for. That's why I'm running. I took the long road to tell you that. I'm here to work for the people. Thank you. Specifically, work with any entity willing to work with Asbury Park in a positive manner to matriculate and move Asbury forward in the right direction, economically, socially, and safely. I'm going to be honest. I believe that we have the best location in the world. I believe that we have some of the best people in the world that lives here, that plays here, that visits here. Think about it. We're 55 miles from the greatest city on the face of the earth, New York City. Most of them come here to play. Most of them come here to live over the summer. Why aren't we picking their brains? Why aren't we looking for consultancy from them? Or vice versa. Why aren't we offering them anything to possibly get them to move here permanently and commute to the city? Because I believe that's the strength of Asbury. I believe that we pay way too high taxes. $8,000 a year in taxes. It's a lot of tax money for a 1.42 square mile town. It's a lot of tax money, but it's less than Ocean, is less than Neptune, and is less than, it, no, it's more, I'm saying less. More than Ocean, more than Neptune, and more than Long Branch. My apologies. There's no reason why we shouldn't be less than Neptune, less than Ocean, less than Long Branch. Think about it, per capita, that's a lot of money for the people that's here. We need to come up with innovative ways of cutting taxes. I don't think that cutting school taxes will cut taxes. That's only a dollar and some change, maybe $2 a month, school taxes. It's other ways of cutting taxes, bringing that industry. I believe that working closely with our city officials, working closely with the Board of Education and with the school officials, working closely with the community, we can make some things happen in a positive light economically. Making sure that Main Street, Asbury Avenue, and Lake Avenue are properly divided between the walkers, the drivers, and the riders. We got to make sure that everybody's comfortable here. We got to make sure that there's enough recreation to remove our kids from the street. And I'm specifically talking about the Southwest Quadrant. Specifically about the Southwest Quadrant. If you think about it, there are no laundromats. There's one laundromat on Prospect Avenue on the Southwest Quadrant. The Boys Club is there, but it's really catered to early childhood to about fourth grade now. Growing up, the Boys Club encompassed every age up to 40. There are no recreational outlets on the west side other than the basketball courts in Asbury Park. The jobs, scarce. Most of the jobs are downtown, and again, as Danny spoke of, those jobs are normally given to family members and those people who are trusted or entrusted to make sure that the agenda of the job or the business is carried out effectively and efficiently, and I understand that. But the people here, they need some type of safety net, and there's nothing more safe than having an outlet to earn, to show your potential, to maximize your potential, to have something to be proud about or to be proud of. It's hard to be proud to being on social services. It's hard to be proud walking everywhere. Danny spoke of people riding bikes. Most of them walk. It's hard to be proud about these things. But again, we have those outlets coming from New York. Not even outlets. We have those influences coming from New York. We have those influences coming from Philly. We have those influences coming from South Jersey and North Jersey. It's time for us to create a dialogue. Maybe create some clubs. Create some clubs. Create some advisory boards for our police. Create some advisory boards for our council. Because we don't have all the answers. The people who are living and working in the community have the answers. The people who are paying those taxes have the answers. The people who are walking and not riding have those answers. The people who are paying to get on the beach have those answers. The people who are paying for parking have those answers. We need to open up the dialogue. We need to open up the table. Pull a seat up to the table because I'm willing to listen. I don't care if I'm the only city council member there listening. I'm going to listen and I'm going to try to make something happen. I'm going to try the best of my ability with every breath in my body for the city of Asbury Park to move forward as one. That's the real reasons I'm running for city council. For the people. That's the only reason we're here. It's pretty selfish to live life just for yourself. I come from a family where the door was always open, not just to me, but to other families, to other people. And I know it can work. I'm a product of it. Two college degrees. Survived. Surviving. A great father. Becoming a better man every day. Only thing I'm asking is for a vote. I'm asking for understanding. I'm asking for communication. If we can give each other four things, communication, respect, understanding, and convenience, we'll never fail as a city. So if you take those things and think about it, I'll leave my number here in this interview. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to do it, but I'm going to do it anyway. Area code 646-773-7158. Call me. Any questions you have, any concerns you may have, or any ideas you may want to tap into, I'm here. Stephen Williams, City Council, November 8th, 2016. Stephen, Danny, and Kenneth, thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Yvonne Clayton, and I am a product of Asbury Park. I spent my youth here going to local schools. I attended Banks Avenue, which is known as Obama now, and Bond Street School, which is defunct. I'm a proud graduate of Asbury Park High School. After high school, I went on to college, and after college, I moved to New York City. But Asbury Park always remained my home. Because this is where my family was. This is where we spent holidays. And this is where my friends came. to celebrate being at the shore. In 2011, I moved back full-time with my husband because we could see that there were wonderful things going to happen in Asbury Park, and we wanted to be a part of that. I was disappointed by the rate of development on Springwood Avenue and other quality of life issues. And that's why in 2014, I decided to run for office. This was my first foray into politics. Never had I ever anticipated or thought that I would run for anything. But I saw an opportunity and I thought I could make a difference. And that's why I ran. I'm running for re-election, and I'm running for re-election because I believe that this team has done a great job for the city. There's still much to be done, and this is going to be our opportunity. When I think that in 2009, the Springwood Avenue Park was thought of, we started raising funds, but nothing happened, and this year, there's a new park. There's a park where families can come. There's a park that has had concert series and people who have come out to this park who have never been on the west side. So I think that we've done great things. And then there's the development. I talked to residents who said, nobody cares. Nobody cares about what's going on the west side. Nothing is going to happen here forever. That's not a reality anymore. We worked with partners. We partnered with our state senator. We partnered with the developer to make sure that we were going to get the funds needed. We were turned down twice, but we did not give up. We kept coming back again and again and again. And now the reality is that within the next 3 to 4 months, you're going to start to see development on Springwood Avenue. And within 18 months, there will be new residents, there will be commercial space, and there will be families. And at last, what we've been hoping for and wishing for is going to happen. And there are so many other quality of life issues that we've been addressing. We've had this spring, the citywide spring and fall cleanup that's brought our youth together with different members of the community. There are a number of reasons why I'm running for council, but the main reason is this is a wonderful, diverse city that I just want to see grow and develop and continue the momentum that has been started. Two major concerns. The first is workforce development, creating opportunities for our residents to have jobs, not necessarily in Asbury Park, but so that they can go out into the outer communities and have jobs. We need to do more than we have in the past. One of the things that we are doing presently is we created a request for a proposal for a workforce developer. And we are ready to hire that individual who's going to come in and help us work together to create programs for youth, especially the 18 to 25 age group, and for any other members of our community who would like the assistance that we want to provide to them. My second major concern is it's a positive and it's a negative. It's redevelopment. I don't want the redevelopment that happens in this city to destroy this city. It is a wonderful, creative, diverse place. I don't want to see people get displaced because they can't afford to live here. So a real concern is going to be, how do we balance new construction with high-end apartments and affordable housing, so that everyone that lives here today can continue to live here. And that is what we're working on, and that's why you'll see that even on the Springwood Avenue development, it's going to be low and middle income housing. there is even going to be an affordable housing condominium, and that will have rental units. So there are positive things happening, but we just have to make sure that this doesn't become a city where only investors are buying properties and only people who have huge amounts of money can afford to live here. First and foremost will be the completion of the Boston Way and Renaissance Village and Turf Club projects on Springwood Avenue. Why? Because this will bring people back into the community. It's going to provide affordable housing because Boston Way is low and middle income, and the Renaissance Village is middle income. The Turf Club project is condominiums, but affordable condominiums with rental units, and they are special. You have to live there. It's not just for investment. And they are also going to have incentives where police and firemen will get a break because it brings them into the community for which they are serving. Next, I think it's important that we implement a workforce initiative. So we're going to continue to work with the businesses and developers to provide opportunities for our residents. We're going to use as an example the Salt School. The Salt School was the school that was developed by the manager of the Asbury. 10 weeks of training for 120 of our residents, 60 of whom were hired. Now, the others weren't hired by the Asbury, but because of the training, they had opportunities where they could go out and get jobs in other types of hotels and service industries. So we want to upgrade the train station to make coming into Asbury a more enjoyable experience. And then we're going to follow closely the development and building of the property that's formerly known as the Esperanza and will be known as 1101 Ocean Avenue. The building of 1101 Ocean Avenue is going to ensure that we get off of transitional aid from the state. And that's going to be important because once we get off transitional aid, it means that the city is responsible for what happens here, that we don't have to go to the state every time we want to do something to get their approval. And also, it will provide a tax base for our city. And what happens when we have a tax base? Property taxes go down. And it will make home ownership more affordable for more of our residents. We're going to continue to partner with the school system to create opportunities for our youth. And also, because I've been a mentor with the CAN expungement program, we are going to try to get legislation that will make it easier for ex-offenders to clear their record. You know, when you've lived a life free of crime, you are a contributing member of society. Why continue to punish you that you can't vote, that you can't live in certain housing, that you can't get a mortgage? So these are the things that I am committed to doing in the next 4 years. And at the same time, we're going to continue to be physically conservative so that we use the resources that are available to us in the most advantageous method. And last, I pledge to you that we're going to do our best to make Asbury Park the best it can be for all of its citizens.